You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens. I hope this podcast finds you extraordinarily well. This is our third story for the month of October 2023, issue 205. I hope that these stories are keeping you well, whether this is on your daily commute, a daily walk, maybe a not-so-daily walk, maybe doing some dishes or some gardening, or just sitting and relaxing while you're trying to fall asleep. Thank you for joining us each and every story. Your support means the world to us, and it literally means that we can continue to bring you these magazines each and every month. So if you are a longtime supporter, thank you from the bottom of my heart. You make this possible. And if you haven't supported us yet, please consider doing so. Please go to patreon.com/Clarkesworld. And thank you. Our story is titled Down to the Root and is by Lisa Papademetriou. Lisa Papademetriou lives in Northampton, Massachusetts, and is the author of over 20 novels for young readers. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. ASY, Alliance Standard Year, 2141. Manwin's heart was in a bag, carefully desiccated. It had been wrapped in a woven sack, which was then placed in a wooden box carved with a life tree pattern. The tree was inlaid betelwood and gleamed with shifting blue-black iridescence under the artificial lighting. Luriel's fingertips traced up the trunk, across one of the major branches, down a twig, to a leaf. It curled at the tip, reaching toward the sky. "Perhaps this is me," she thought. Closing her eyes, she concentrated on inhaling shallowly, not stopping at the sharp stab beneath her breastbone. This wasn't her first cryogenic thaw. It was a painful process. It irritated her, this pain, but it didn't frighten her. She had learned to separate pain from fear. People often conflate the two, but pain didn't have to mean danger. Right now, it meant healing from the freezing process that made it possible to suspend her body in time for distant space travel. Reversing the process was painful and slow. That was why it began a full month before the ship touched down. In many ways, the ship was the perfect place to recuperate. There wasn't much to do anyway, and the light gravity made it easier to move. The strangest thing about waking up from suspension was the way in which the tech had changed. The young man who had helped her into the pod was the same as the one who hovered over her when she opened her eyes, although it had taken her a moment to register that. He had lost weight and was 11 years older. She, meanwhile, was unchanged. It gave the entire trip a quality of unreality, or rather, an extra layer of unreality. She wondered what it would be like for Manwin. His waking would be slower, she guessed. She wasn't sure that he would remember her right away or ever. Not the way that she remembered him. If he remembered her at all, it would always be the way a tree remembers. Deep in the rings, down to the root. ASY 2122. 19 years earlier. What does this mean? Luriel's eyes scanned the information on the screen. Replacement crew? Sabriha Namawas? Mar Newt? And DS-93 Cerces? What? Namoto leaned over to read the screen. When he came to the final name, he uttered an expletive of amazement. What? What is it? You've got a Cercean on the new team. I don't know what that is. A clone? She squinted at the numbers and letters. Would she really call her coworker DS-93? No, not a clone. Not exactly. I mean, nobody really knows what their deal is. Cerces is isolationist. Nobody ever leaves the planet, or hardly anybody does. It's not that unusual. Oh, right. I forgot who I was talking to. Reclining in his chair, Namoto began fiddling with his handheld. But Cerces makes Ithkartha look like the Diamond Road. Ithkartha trades with other planets. Luriel jabbed a finger at the information hologram, the info holo which disappeared. Ithkartha joined the Alliance. Namoto rolled his eyes. Don't get your back up, I'm just saying. It's really rare to meet a Cercean. They don't believe in travel or combat. They don't believe in travel? It's because they're immortal or something. They're what? What does that have to do with travel? Hey, look, I'm just a biomanagement underling who's rotating off this post in 5 standard days. I don't know anything about other civilizations. I'm probably wrong anyway. L'Oreal frowned. Well, it was true. He probably was wrong. When it came to subjects outside of his area of expertise, Nemoto often was. He never shut up. That was why. She couldn't remember how many times the AI had pointed out his exaggerations. You'll have a year and a half to hear all about Cersus, Nemoto added. And all about wherever the others are from, too. Perfect, L'Oreal heard the bitterness in her own voice. He cocked his head, a smile creeping up the side of his face. Well, well, look who's going to miss me. L'Oreal checked the oxygenometer and grav readings. Oh, shut the hell up, Nemoto, she growled. He just laughed. This time, at least, he was right. She would miss him. She had been on the ship for 18 standard months. She was halfway through her rotation. Every 6 months, 3 members of the crew would cycle off and be replaced. Most of the crew was there to run operations, assessing, repairing, and sometimes replacing parts of the complex patchwork of mismatched satellites that kept the Alliance in contact. Nemoto had been L'Oreal's partner since the day she arrived and had trained her in the basics of both interior and exterior biomanagement, which basically meant monitoring and adjusting the ship's systems so that nobody died. Nemoto was a pain, no doubt, but L'Oreal had heard enough horror stories of ghost ships full of dead crew to appreciate his competence. Besides, she hated meeting new people, and now this unknown Cersian was going to be her partner until the day she stepped off the ship. When the pod locked into place, the crew members disembarked one at a time. The ship was utilitarian, and like everything Alliance made, cobbled together with spare parts. The new crew, therefore, was forced to make their first appearance backward through the bunker tube, ass first, khaki coverall stretched at the rear as they climbed down the ladder. The first crew member, Mar, laughed as he made his awkward entrance. His black eyes shone as he ran a hand over his close-cropped hair and said, I'm glad you all got a look at my best feature first. Subriha was next. Her hair was back in a severe ponytail, and the scar that ran from the corner of her mouth to her ear twisted her lips into a permanent sneer. She must have seen some fighting, L'Oreal realized. That was good. Even though they were technically non-combatants, just techs aboard a comm ship, it was still possible that they could get boarded or caught in a skirmish. And then finally, the Cersian. He was slender, with brown hair that brushed his shoulders. When he was introduced to L'Oreal, he took her hands in his and gazed into her face for a long moment with eyes that were an unusual shade of hazel, almost amber. She stood there transfixed. Finally, he nodded and dropped her hands. She looked over at Nemoto, who rolled his eyes. Later, when the Cersian retreated to his bunk, Nemoto leaned over and whispered, Wow, you really are going to miss me. The Cersian was certainly different from Nemoto. He hardly ever spoke, for one thing. When L'Oreal had asked what he would like to be called, if he wanted to be called DS-93 or some other nickname, he shook his head and said that names had no meaning on his planet. Nemoto was still aboard then, and he said, This guy looks like my cousin Manwin. And so Julia had taken to calling the Cersian Manwin, and he never objected. So Manwin he became. Even after Nemoto, Julia, and Wendell had boarded the pod and left. Manwin was thoughtful. He didn't make jokes or mistakes. There are moments that L'Oreal thought that he was like some of the AI hollows she had interacted with. But he wasn't exactly like them either. He was calm, he was analytical, but he wasn't cold. He was simply strange. A stranger. After 6 months with the same crew, one forgot how to interact with the unknown. How to hold conversations that weren't in shorthand, how to exist with someone you could not predict. L'Oreal found it irritating and exhausting. She didn't exactly miss Nemoto, but she definitely missed the predictability of him. A yellow light flashed, and L'Oreal put her tablet aside to check the bios. What's happening? Manwin asked as he made his way back into their small shared hold. Over oxygenation, L'Oreal replied, tapping the hollow. Slight adjustment. Do you mind if I move this? Manwin asked as he picked up the tablet she had placed in his chair. A small red leaf fell from the cover and fluttered to the floor. Don't touch it, Luriel commanded as he bent toward the leaf. He bowed his head as she reached for it. It's fragile, she explained, picking it up by the stem. He handed over the tablet so that she could tuck the leaf back into place. It's special, he said. No, she snapped the tablet closed. Well, just special to me. What else is there? Their gaze touched. Right. Is it from your homeworld? Manwin asked. Yes. Luriel hesitated a moment, then pulled out the leaf again. Back home, she had pressed it flat between the pages of an old-fashioned book, and it was faded now, thin and brittle, slightly iridescent and almost transparent, like the wing of a dragonfly. Do you see the veins? She asked, tracing a finger along the largest. Manwin nodded. Yes, and the way it branches, and the branches branch. Across the entire surface, Luriel agreed. Under the skin, I thought it was so beautiful. Manwin didn't ask to hold the leaf or to inspect it more closely as carefully. She slid the leaf into the pocket in her tablet cover and snapped it closed. It's nice to have the thing, the physical thing, Manwin said. Did you bring anything with you? Luriel asked. Manwin laughed. What? I brought everything with me, he said, but when she asked him to explain, he just shook his head and turned back to the controls. After 5 days, the newness of the shipmates wore off. After 5 weeks, it shifted to familiarity. After 3 months, it became almost impossible for Luriel to remember what it had been like with Namoto at the controls. Manwin was as familiar as the font on a holoscreen. His head tilted upward suddenly as the craft shuddered. Just some unlocked debris, Luriel said. There was a significant amount of junk along their current orbit. Some of it was detritus from launches or conflicts, things that were supposed to be logged by the crews, but often weren't. And some of it was just natural meteoroid. But anything could pick up enough speed to cause damage. Maybe check the array? Manwin pulled up the hollow. Luriel frowned at the reading. Oh, looks like it might have chipped a panel. Swiping through the images, she pinpointed the location of the damage. Her flesh went cold, and she felt dizzy. It's worse than it sounded, Manwin said. One of us will have to get out there. She heard the reluctance in her own voice. I'll go, Manwin stood up, reaching for his walk suit. Gratitude washed over her. The only part of her job that she hated was going outside for repairs, with just a tether between her suit and craft. Even though the ship was just a thin skin protecting her from the dangerous void of space, she preferred to keep that skin on. Manwin fastened the suit. We're lucky that chunk of whatever didn't hit the main hull. That's the thing about a job like ours, Luriel agreed, her voice grim. There are a million ways to die. A light flared beyond the window as she welded a new part onto the satellite. Manwin often spent his breaks visiting the main deck, silently observing the exterior of the ship. Luriel began to think of it as watching the scenery pass by, as her father used to say when she was young and stuck by his side on long drives. Sometimes, like today, Luriel would go with Manwin. She liked watching Loomis or Sabriha extract data from non-functional satellites, retranslate, and encrypt. They were senior personnel with one of the most important and complex jobs on the ship. Hark and Ilya located satellites and ran diagnostics. And then there was a team of techs, Mar, Brendov, Ji, Vandun, who made repairs. Usually at least 3 of them would be on the deck, analyzing satellites and orbits, planning repairs or else heading out to make them. Comtechs were usually out spacewalking at least once in any 24-hour cycle. Luriel had briefly considered training for comms tech. The pay was excellent, but knew that the walks would make it unbearable. Vandun touched a link in her ear. What's up, Ji? Ji's head shook from side to side. Feeling a little. Let's bring it in, Vandun said. Should I finish? She's voice was tinny over the comms. Let Mar do it. You're 61 minutes ahead of schedule. It's no problem. Van Dune wasn't making a suggestion. She started retracting the main tether, pulling Xi into the airlock.
Puncture? Manwin asked.
Maybe. With a slow leak or pinprick hole, she wouldn't pass out right away. There's so much shrapnel on these damaged satellites. Van Dune's voice was grim. Could be anything. We'll have to put the suit through assessment. Do we even know if the satellite is salvageable? Luriel asked.
We try regardless, Sapriha muttered. It's the job.
Luriel glanced at Manwin, who was watching Z approach the airlock. She would be fine once the suit cleared assessment. She'd probably be on another walk tomorrow. Luriel wondered if she even thought about the danger. She supposed that there were some people who just didn't mind it. Sabriha stuck her head through the entryway.
Private wire came in on the bits, she said, giving Luriel a small handheld.
Luriel read the short message. Then she read it again. Thank you. She handed the device back to Sabriha, who stared down at the screen. Her scar twisted slightly as she said,
I'm sorry.
It's not a surprise. Still not meeting her eyes, Sabriha nodded and turned away. Manwin had watched the whole exchange without speaking a word. Luriel knew that he was trying to give her space. It was absurd having to pretend that they weren't 3 feet apart. There was no point in pretending that everything was fine.
My brother died, she said at last.
Manwin turned and stared at her. She was looking at the screen, but she could feel his eyes on her.
How?
He'd been in the hospital for almost a year when I left, the doctor said.
She shrugged, shook her head.
Manwin let this information fall on him like rain.
How horrible.
Her mother had wanted her to stay, but her father had understood. She knew that Rojin was not going to get better. There was nothing she could do to ease his suffering. So she had eased her own.
What made him happy? Manwin asked.
In life. What did he love?
Surfing? Luriel said, and as the word left her lips, she saw him. Age 13, wobbling on a board as a small wave carried him toward the black sand. The sun was bright, casting a brilliant glare across the water, and Rojin let out a triumphant whoop as he fell off into the sea. Oh, he could stay in the ocean for days. His fingers would get all wrinkly. Even his toes would wrinkle. Once he fell asleep on the couch, and I could tell by his movements that he was dreaming of surfing.
That sounds beautiful.
It was.
Did your brother ever teach you to surf?
No, Luriel replied. I taught him. A light flashed on the holoscreen and Luriel refocused on the information in front of her. Biomanagement required attention. She and Manwin held the ship's lives in the palms of their hands. Sometimes she imagined cradling them there like they were baby birds. I shouldn't let him take all the walks, Luriel thought as she monitored Manwin's vitals from the interior of the ship. It isn't fair. Another month had passed. This time solar activity had affected the stabilizers. As usual, Manwin had volunteered to take the exterior walk and Luriel had let him. Watching him from her place at the panel, she realized that she hadn't been outside of the craft in 5 weeks. He gave the signal and she opened the airlock for him, ran the pressurization for several minutes, then opened the secondary hatch.
I should do the next one, Luriel said.
Manwin looked at her, his piercing yellow eye seeming to bore through her skull, reading her mind.
It doesn't bother me, she huffed.
Doesn't bother me either.
A smile flickered at Manwin's lips.
It's okay, truly, I like it.
What does that mean? Of course it's okay. She stabbed at the holo readings with her fingers, making her small movements as violent as possible as she busied herself with her work. Why doesn't anyone else hate the walks? She wondered. She had never liked them, but she used to be able to tolerate them. Ever since her brother died, though, the seed of fear had spilled open and begun to grow deep inside her, climbing through her body and limbs like a vine. It embarrassed her to be this way.
I'll do the next one.
All right.
Manwin didn't react or apologize. He simply hung up his suit carefully, then climbed, cat-like, back into his narrow seat.
The two worked without speaking. Their movements and low hum of machinery was the only sound. Beyond the round glass porthole, the stars burned on. After a while, her anger exhausted itself in the silence, like a candle without oxygen.
"You really don't mind it?" she asked suddenly. Turning to face her, Menwin cocked his head, clearly considering.
"No."
"Is it because..." Luriel felt her face go hot.
"Oh, maybe you don't have anything to lose?"
Menwin ran his fingertips over the gouged arms of his refurbished chair, seeming to struggle with the question. After a moment, he asked,
"What do you mean?"
She was going to have to say it.
"I've heard..."
Luriel's voice trailed off. His amber eyes narrowed, crinkling at the corners, and she realized that he was amused by her discomfort.
It's nothing. It's just a weird rumor."
Menwin seemed pleased at the possibility that he might be the subject of gossip.
"About me?"
"About Circeans." He leaned back in his chair, which let out a creak.
"What about us?"
"That you're immortal?" The amusement evaporated around him. Menwin went perfectly still, even his breath seemed to pause.
"Is it true?"
Luriel pressed.
"Of course not,"
Menwin replied. And then, just as she was about to laugh at herself at the fact that he'd had her there for a moment, he added,
"Not in the way you mean."
He turned back to his hollow, scanning the information. She studied his profile, the straight angle of his nose and the slight way his lower lip pressed against the upper. His expression was hard to read.
"So, you are?"
Menwin turned his face toward the porthole.
"Time is a circle," he stated.
"Theoretically," Luriel agreed.
"No, I mean our time. Circean time. Our lives are circular."
She nodded, then stopped herself.
"What does that mean?"
"We have a cycle, and we die, and we return to the soil, and eventually we are reborn."
"Reincarnation."
"We aren't reincarnated. We are reborn as ourselves."
Her mind struggled to form this into sense.
"So you retain your memories?"
"Some of them. We retain the lessons in our bodies. Our lives aren't like yours. You live in a straight line. We live in cycles and circles."
Luriel's thoughts felt thick. She wasn't sure whether Manwin was describing a belief system or some aspect of reality.
"What about travel?"
"What about it?
Is it against your religion?"
"We must return to the soil of our planet," Manwin explained. "If we don't, the circle is broken."
He smiled at her confusion.
"We're a part of Circeus, and Circeus is within us."
"Like a plant?"
she asked. The word plant landed at the end of her question with an inelegant splat. But it was difficult to insult or disturb Manwin.
"Yes," he replied. "Like that."
His voice was soft, and the words seemed to flutter to the floor between them. Luriel thought of the skeleton leaf she had brought from Ithkartha.
"So basically, if you don't make it back to your homeworld, then you're dead?"
As he turned back to her, his gaze was serene.
"Then I'm dead."
"Why would you ever leave?"
Luriel asked. Menwin's smile seemed thoughtful.
"There are a million ways to die," he said.
Subriha scowled into her coffee as Loomis thundered across the endless loop of treadmill behind her. Luriel was scanning the hollows and eating a protein bar straight from the silver wrapper.
"Any news across the bits?"
Menwin asked as he popped a pod of the coffee machine and reached for a mug. "The usual, elections on Darmok in 2 days." Luriel took another bite of her chalky breakfast.
"There were explosions outside the capital," Subriha said darkly. "A couple thousand casualties."
Luriel looked up at her, then glanced at Menwin. Her eyes locked with hers for a moment, then flicked to Loomis, who was saying,
"That shit's classified, Subriha."
The Alliance can keep it out of the news, Sabriha shot back, but they shouldn't. Another terrorist attack? Loomis slammed his hand against the emergency stop button and the treadmill came to a quick, smooth stop. He hopped off and turned to face her. Mass panic isn't going to help the situation. There's an election to run.
Yeah,
but if it's Rova? There's no evidence that it is. It could just be a local conflict. People should be prepared, Sabriha insisted.
Prepared for what? Loomis demanded. Be prepared to die in their sleep? Be prepared to watch their loved ones burn with invisible fire? It isn't Rova.
Loomis's thick eyebrows were drawn together, his muscles taut as he pointed a finger at Sabriha.
It's not our job to speculate. Get that finger out of my face, Sabriha growled.
Hey, wait a minute, Lariel said. How could Rova have gotten as far as Darmok? She sneaked a glass at Manwin, whose face was perfectly still, betraying nothing. But Lariel knew what he must be thinking. She had learned enough about Cersis to know it was in the same system as Darmok.
Sabriha nodded. That's what I'd like to know.
Our job is just to repair satellites and pass along failed comms, Manwin's voice was gentle, like rain falling on a fire. Not to determine what they mean or what action to take. We're just a tiny moving part in a vast machine.
Loomis's dark eye glared at him. You're not even part of this, Cercean, he snapped. Your planet's going to stay neutral all the way into oblivion.
He stormed out of the break room, rage pouring from his posture like heat from an oven. The silence that followed his exit was thick with unspoken emotion. Lariel knew, they all knew, that Rova's drones had systematically destroyed part of Loomis's homeworld. It was a small, out-of-the-way moon that had no discernible strategic advantage. The inhabitants had been caught completely off guard.
Sabriha sighed. He's in pain, Manwin finished.
That's no excuse, Lariel replied. Her heart felt tight, like a fist, or a bud at the end of a stem.
No, Manwin agreed. It's not an excuse.
His amber eyes lingered on the hatchway Loomis had passed through.
It's just a reason.
Lariel was worried about how she smelled. She was conscientious about hygiene and used the rinseless shampoo and skin wash regularly, but she also suspected that she might have a personal odor that she wasn't aware of. She knew one thing. Manwin did. There was a lake on Ithkartha, far to the north. It was a huge lake, clear as glass, with water so clean that you could drink it. The lake was dotted with small islands, and her family owned one of these tiny islands on which her father had built a small house. That far north, away from the large city where she usually lived, the night sky was full of brilliant stars, and the air smelled different. It was sweet and fresh, like a leaf crushed between the fingers. But it was unique, not like any particular leaf that she knew, but more like the smell that leaves might have dreamed of or aspired to. She later realized that the smell came from a particular moss that grew on the trees that lived on the islands in the center of that clear lake. That was how Manwin smelled. She noticed it the very first day that they worked together, enclosed in that small space, seated back to back in their dilapidated chairs made from cast-off parts. She had thought that he might have used a particular product before boarding the vessel, but over the weeks the smell had neither faded nor changed, and she was beginning to realize that it was simply him. She had been in tight spaces with others before, all through training and the many months she had worked with Namoto. Everyone had a personal smell, often acrid or sour, sometimes overlaid with the fragrance of soap or shampoo. Namoto always smelled vaguely feral, like the fur of a ferret. She wondered how she smelled to Manwin. Not too bad, she hoped. His shoulders stooped slightly forward, his long, delicate fingers tracing lines of bio readings. Her brother had hands like that. When they were young, their father said that he should be a dentist. Manwin made a noise, a slight grunt.
What's up? Lariel asked.
Our trajectory is going to put us in the path of some radiation in a day or two, Manwin explained. We'll have to look at mitigation.
that solar activity has been quiet for a while now might not be a problem. Anwen frowned.
Where I'm from, you've always got to plan for unexpected solar events.
I didn't know there was much instability near Cersus, Luriel said.
No, sorry. I'm talking about Iwadne. My family left Cersus when I was 16.
Oh. This news shocked Luriel. So, Iwadne is your homeworld?
Iwadne is where my parents live. There is only one true homeworld.
You miss Cersus more than Iwadne?
Of course.
Manwin was quiet for a moment. Of course, he repeated, more quietly this time. Luriel resisted the urge to make herself busy with something else. She could see that Manwin was uncomfortable.
Why did your family leave?
My parents had ideas that were unpopular.
Dissent isn't tolerated on Cersus?
Dissent is hardly even recognized as a concept. Cersus doesn't really have much to do with other worlds. The Central Council tolerates some limited visits from scholars. Other than that, very few outsiders ever set foot on Cersus.
A light flashed and Manwin turned to make an adjustment. For a moment, Luriel thought that the conversation had ended, but then Manwin turned back to face her.
My parents wanted to open up trade, encourage cultural exchanges with other planets and moons. The Central Council proclaimed it treason.
So you can't go back?
Maybe I could, Manwin admitted. I don't know.
You don't want to.
Manwin inhaled deeply, exhaled slowly in a way that was too controlled to be called a sigh.
Sometimes I remember what it was like. It's peaceful, Manwin said. But then, there's something to this, too. To being out among the stars. To be ourselves, you know? And there's something to having this one single life. A circle is beautiful, but an arrow, it flies.
His words dropped like a stone into deep water, falling between them. There was no night aboard the craft, not in the way that there had been back home on Ithkartha, but there was still the moment before sleep when Luriel's body was quiet, but her mind was still active. Often she spent the time considering Manwin. His family had chosen to leave the safety of their world and their eternal life, real or imagined, and he had deliberately inserted himself into danger, even though the ongoing conflict between the Alliance and Rova didn't matter to Cersus, or Cersus didn't matter to it. He was far from this homeworld, but still tethered there only by the frail, invisible line of history. She thought of Ithkartha. Her home was not as far as his. The line leading back was just as frail, just as likely to break. Somehow, Manwin's presence reminded her that she could die out here. She might never make it home. They were all taking the same risk. It was no different from the risk her brother had taken out on the waves. Lulled by the mundanity of her job and the familiarity of their interplanetary circuit, she had never really considered it before. Now, every night, the thought of eternal silence was the last one she had before she fell asleep. Luriel felt the throb of her blood at the tips of her ears. Her heart was not racing, but she was somehow very aware of it, of the labor of her lungs, the sound as she inhaled the oxygenated air, the suit against her skin, the slight tickle of a wayward hair at her neck. Manwin was less than 20 feet away, but he was inside and she was outside. She could see him through the glass panel monitoring her vitals. It was her turn. Another week, another small exterior adjustment needed. She had forced herself to put on the suit, to step into the hatchway. It was harder than it needed to be.
You need to do this more often, she told herself, not less. It gets harder when you avoid it.
The travel had caused a slight realignment of the solar array. This was common. It was routine. Someone had to fix it. Forcing herself to focus on the gold panel before her, she made a slight shift in angle. Then another. Once absorbed in the task, her awareness of herself fell away. This was delicate work made challenging by the thick suit and her necessary slow movements. 2 hours passed, and finally her reading showed the panel was in proper alignment. She glanced up at Manwin for confirmation, who gave her the thumbs up before setting the retract. She exhaled deeply, realizing that she'd done it. The next walk would be Manwin's. Or maybe she would volunteer to take that one, too. She owed him, after all. She could take a few in a row. Casting her eyes around, she realized how peaceful it was out here. This was why Manwin loved the walks and watching the scenery. The star's ancient light had traveled across millions of miles for countless years, just to fall on her now as she floated, dreamlike, among them. Gently, the line pulled Luriel back toward the entry hatch, and she surprised herself by feeling disappointed that she couldn't stay outside just a little longer. This isn't bad, she realized. She felt powerful. The risk she was taking gave her strength. She saw Manwin smile. She smiled back. His expression changed an instant before a projectile shot past her, blasting into the transparent aperture. She caught the flash of movement as Manwin was knocked sideways just before the emergency bulkhead slammed into place, barricading the interior. Another projectile hit the right thruster. Twisting, Luriel saw the Rova scout as it fired off another round. She heard herself screaming, saw the flash of emergency light, and knew the rest of the vessel was headed for lockdown and landing. Hauling herself along the tether, she raced toward the ship and slammed her palm against the airlock mechanism. It refused to budge. Cursing, she punched in the override protocol, cursing again at the red light that denied access. Luriel forced herself to breathe deeply, concentrating on the override as she punched it in again, more slowly this time. Finally, the airlock slipped open and she darted in, closing the door behind her. Inside the small chamber, she had to wait an excruciating 70 seconds before she could ditch her bulky suit, which she left on the floor as she raced into the chamber that held Manwin. He was pinned against the barricade. It had come down just after the first hit, which had punched two matching holes in the hull, roughly the size of her hand. Even in the short instant the holes had been active, the gruesome cold of space managed to lower the temperature in the tank. Rova used B-coils, clean slicing chemical lasers left over from the last regime, to minimize damage so they could reuse the captured equipment and data. No doubt they were planning to take out the biosystems and thrusters, then wait for the crew to asphyxiate before boarding. Separated from the larger compartments by the emergency barricade, Luriel and Manwin's tank would be the first to run out of oxygen. They had to get out of there. They'd have to take the pod. "I've got you," she shouted as Manwin let out a horrifying screech. "Help me. Help me." Her muscles screamed. It was like trying to move a train car. Manwin was trying to form a word, and her mind managed to make sense of the syllables. The barricade. Looking closely, she realized with horror that Manwin's safety restraint was caught beneath the steel bulkhead, the force crushing him. She would have to bring up the barricade to free him. While it was open, the gaping holes would allow the vacuum of space to suck away their precious oxygen. But if she moved fast enough, she could free Manwin. If only. Deploy the pod and get the hell out of there while the rest of the crew scrambles for an emergency landing on the planet below. One. She reached for the release. Two. She set her feet against the control panel. Three. In a single motion, she yanked the lever and reached for Manwin's restraints. Catching sight of the Rova ship, she unbuckled Manwin, her fingers fumbling on the metal clasps, which had already turned burningly cold. Luriel tried not to imagine the void sucking the oxygen from the air around her as she finally managed to pry them open. Yanking him forward, she pushed the straps from his shoulders and wrenched him from his chair. Manwin slipped to the floor as she hauled the lever backward. The steel panel slammed into place. Luriel struggled to breathe. She needed more oxygen. "Manwin," she said, crawling toward him. She tried to haul him upright, but his head lolled at an awkward angle. His eyes flicked to hers and softened. "You're okay," she whispered. "You're going to be okay. We just have to make it to the pod," she thought. "I'll drag him. I can drag him. He's light. I can drag him." She tested his weight, but he was heavy, even for her adrenaline-fueled muscles.
Manwin, help, she begged. You have to help me.
He didn't respond. His gaze was vacant, his chest was still. Manwin was dead. Killed by the safety feature designed to protect him. The wound was getting worse. It started as a long red gash that had steadily puffed up and began to ooze clear liquid. This morning, the area near the wound was purple. It's not good, Manwin, she said aloud. She had buckled him upright in the escape pod seat so he wouldn't be tossed around during their flight. And he was still seated there. Sometimes she imagined that he was just asleep. Even after 3 weeks, he still smelled like moss. Lauriel ran her index finger over the tight, hot skin that covered her swollen ankle. She had been thrown against the rough corner of a soldered-together equipment panel during emergency pod landing. The sharp edge had opened a long gash along her skin. Once she had managed to free herself from her restraint harness, she took stock. Of course, the pod had emergency supplies, 5 days' worth of food for 2 people and a first aid kit, and she had managed to stop bleeding and apply some antibac. But her search for water had necessitated a trek through thick vegetation of unknown classification. The good news was that she had managed to find a stream close to the landing site and had successfully purified enough water to stay hydrated. The bad news was that her wound had reopened and had become infected. She was out of antibac and was feeling lightheaded and feverish. Stabbing pain shot up her right leg. Manwin, she whispered. It was silly, she knew. He couldn't hear her. He was still in the pod for one thing, and for another, he was still dead. She had made a camp for herself outside under the open sky, where she could breathe. I have to get up now. It was time to haul herself into the pod to check that the encrypted emergency beacon was still sending. She altered the message every day so that it would be clear that she was still alive. But she was tired. She was so tired and thirsty. Although it was a short trek to the stream, Lauriel was too weak to get more water. Something wet plopped on her cheek, right beside her nose. She opened her eyes. Overhead, the sky was gray. Another fat, wet drop landed on her face. Then more began to fall in a steady rhythm. Rain. There was no weather on board a spaceship. It had been almost 2 years since she had felt rain. When Lauriel was small, she and Rogin had loved to go outside in the rain. They would sit at the curb and send boats down the stream that formed in the storm drain. She would watch the water fall into puddles, sending up splashes and sometimes even forming a bubble that would burst under the weight of another raindrop missile. All that time on the spaceship had almost erased the memory of weather. Her whole life had been contained in that small space, concentrated on a few tasks, linked only to a few people. Now the water sent memories roaring back. Lauriel opened her mouth, letting the rain fall in. Hey. Hey. Her eyes were open, but she couldn't focus. A bright light blinded her in one eye, then the other. She squeezed her eyes shut. Lauriel Canarta, are you with us? Lauriel, can you hear me? The voice was loud and irritating. Why did it have to be so loud? Couldn't this person see she was trying to sleep? She opened her mouth and let out a choking gasp. Her mouth was dry, so dry. Get her some water, another voice murmured, and another moment later, someone slipped a metal tube between her lips. She sucked the cool water and managed to open her eyes. A face appeared in her field of vision. Black eyes and pin-straight black hair that had grown long and hung over his ears. If you missed me that much, you could have just sent to Hollow, Namoto said. Lauriel closed her eyes. Of course. But of all the Alliance ships and all the SAR systems in the universe, she had to be rescued by the one with a smartass. She felt the rocks against her back and knew that she was still on the moon where she had crash-landed, lying at the camp she had made in the shadow of the pod. Her skin felt dry, and she wondered how long she had been lying there while the emergency beacon continued from the ship beside her. Hours? Days? Lauriel, we're going to be moving you, okay? We're taking you to the closest base on Refich. She swallowed. Don't. It's okay, they have a full hospital there. You'll recover and you'll be back on your crew in no time. Namoto was speaking to her as if she were a child, a
child with a hearing problem. Don't. Namoto leaned over her, his lips drawn into a frown.
Something you don't want me to do?
Luriel licked her lips and closed her eyes, forcing herself to concentrate on what she was saying. She didn't have energy. She needed to use as few words as possible.
Don't. Leave Manwin.
She opened her eyes again. Namoto's eyes were sympathetic, serious.
Luriel, he said softly.
He's dead.
She inhaled deeply. Circean, she whispered. We have limited fuel. Every ounce of added weight makes a difference.
Luriel managed to give her head a tiny shake.
Please.
Namoto took her hand and squeezed. She squeezed back.
Okay, he said at last. Okay.
ASY 2141. Luriel gripped the box tightly against her chest as her body pressed against the restraints. After an hour of watching the teal and turquoise planet grow across the vidscreen that fed images from the exterior of the ship, they had finally reached the atmosphere. She focused on her breath, listening to the hiss as air entered her nostrils, feeling the sink in her chest as she exhaled. The pain was gone now. Her body had recovered enough for her to be able to walk almost normally, with only a twinge in her right knee. Her fingers were pressed against the beetlewood life tree. The inlay was slightly raised, and she felt a small leaf imprint against her flesh, reminding her of the skeleton leaf from Mithkartha that she had shown Manwin so long ago. Memory plays tricks in perspective. Things that happened last week can turn hazy or disappear, while incidents separated from us by years can appear as fresh and vivid as if they happened today, as if they were happening now. Almost 20 years had passed since the day she had managed to drag Manwin's dead body through the bunker tube to board the pod and launch away from the unprovoked attack. While she was recovering on the Alliance base, she asked what had happened to her shipmates and learned that none had survived. Rova had justified their attack by accusing the crew of spying, which, looking back on it now, Luriel supposed might have been true. The turbulence ended suddenly, and the ship swooped smoothly over the thick blue-green vegetation. Luriel wondered if the colors on the camera feed were accurate. The dense jungle of Cersus was unlike anything she had ever seen. It was very different from the oceans and lakes of Ithkartha, or the desert of the Alliance base where she spent her recovery. After Namoto and the rest of his crew had deposited her on Merfich, it took Luriel another 2 months to feel well enough to walk. They had managed to save her leg, and rehabilitation had recovered her ability to squat and run. But after that, she was granted leave to visit her parents on Ithkartha, but she declined. She did not want to go home. Instead, Luriel joined another unit just as the fight between the Alliance and Rova heated up. During her second circuit, the conflict escalated to a full-fledged war. Rova expanded their attacks until finally even Cersus joined the Alliance. Both they and her home planet, Ithkartha, paid dearly for joining. And Rova's planets and moons paid dearly as well. Everyone paid, and no one collected, and the years went on. All that was finished now, finished for now. With neither side winning and neither side conceding, but both sides too exhausted to come out of their corners, she didn't really understand what had started the whole conflict and had no idea why it ended. Luriel wished the whole thing had been more decisive, that she could be sure that she had been on the right side, or at least on the winning side. So much of life was that way, equal parts incomprehensible and devastating. But the war had done what Manwin's parents couldn't do. It had opened up diplomacy and trade with Cersus. After all this time, the straight arrow of time had made an opening. Manwin could go home. That was why she was traveling to Cersus, with the remnants of Manwin's heart inside a bag, inside a box, clutched to her chest. It was why she had endured suspension and reanimation, traveled a straight line through her timeline to an unknown place for an uncertain purpose. Perhaps he was like a root. Perhaps she could put Manwin's heart in the earth of Cersus and water it. And months would pass, maybe years, and then what? Maybe Manwin, born from the ground? She didn't know. She didn't want to know. She wanted to believe what she wanted to believe, that if she trusted Manwin's words and placed him in the ground, he would be reborn. And there would have been a meaning to all of it. The war, his death, her life. Manwin would live, and the memory of her would be alive in him, tethering their existences as they moved forward, perhaps in a circle, perhaps in an arrow, flying. None of that might happen, of course. Either way, she would have to travel overland in a dangerous, unmapped territory for an errand that was possibly futile or even delusional. She might very well die on this trip, but there were a million ways to die, and she had long since ceased trying to predict or control which one might be hers. Taking risks gives you strength. Manwin had taught her that. Her family had begged her not to go, to come home to Ithkartha instead, but Manwin had been her friend. She had not been able to save her brother. She had tried to save Manwin and had failed. Now she would try again, and perhaps Manwin could have the life he deserved. She couldn't go home until she had done this. It wasn't an excuse. It was only a reason. The ship came to a standstill. The ship's assistant opened the door to allow the fellow passengers to disembark. Luriel unfastened her restraints and stood. The box was in her right hand as she slung a small bag over her left shoulder. There were three people in front of her, then two, then one. The assistant held out a hand to Luriel, guiding her to the exit. She held that box with Manwin's heart against her own. With a deep breath, Luriel stepped through the doorway, blinking in the sudden, bright sunlight of Cersus. Thank you so much for listening. What are your thoughts? You can go to the About Us page at the Clarkesworld Magazine website itself. And all of our contact information is listed there. So please, if you have a few moments, send us a note. How do you listen? What have you liked? What stories drew you in? We have quite a few stories left for you for the month of October, so I do hope you can come back and listen, should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.